pastimes of Hare Krishna. And then we start from Gauranga. And somebody to operate this bhakta. And somebody to operate this bhakta. Sundara kundala nayana vishala gale sohe vaichanti mana
sundara kundala nayana vishala
gale sohe
Chura chura navaneet jura nirakh rahe narakare rahe sham sham sham
nirakh rahe narakare rahe sham sham
sham sham sham sham
sham sham sham
भक्त सबन मने तारे बिना भक्ति हम अरे तारे
भक्त सबन मने तारे बिना भक्ति हम अरे तारे
भक्त सबन मने तारे बिना भक्ति हम अरे
So, like this, you delivered so many devotees in different ways. Draupadi and Vidura and so many devotees. So, Tumne Tare. But Bina Bhakati, Hama Tade Dware. And we, the author of this song, is telling, I don't have any devotion and I'm standing. And waiting when you deliver me, I'm standing at your door. So kindly take care of me. Mera bhi khabar rakhi, like that he is saying. Le jo khabar hamare rakhe, Ram Ram Ram.
Le jo khabar hamare rakhe, Ram Ram Ram.
Rakhe Ram Ram Ram.
Rakhe Ram Ram Ram.
अर्जुन के रथ तारे गीता के उपदेश तुम्हारे
अर्जुन के रथारे गीता के उपदेश तुम्हारे
अर्जुन के रथारे गीता के उपदेश तुम्हारे
अर्जुन के रथारे
Arjuna was in the battlefield of Kurukshetra at that time. Krishna was driving the rath, he became the driver. And he spoke the famous Bhagavad Gita, which even now people are reading and getting benefited. So, Chakra Sudarshan Dhari.
Chakra Sudarshan Dhari Rathe Sham Sham Sham
Chakra Sudarshan Dhari Rathe Sham Sham Sham
Rathe Sham Sham Sham
Rathe Sham Sham Sham
Jaya Madhav Madan Murari Rathe Ram Ram Ram
Jaya Madhav Madan Murari Rathe Ram Ram Ram
Jaya Keshav Kali Madhavi Rathe Ram Ram Ram
Jaya Keshav Kali Madhavi Rathe
Hare Krishna. So we will discuss from the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, chapter 52. This is a chapter which is very interesting. This is how Krishna married Rukmini and got her as the first wife. It's a very interesting pastime and also a lot of lessons to learn for our own personal life from this pastime. So we'll try to discuss this. So in this, we'll refer to some verses from Srimad Bhagavatam directly. And we'll refer to a series of verses and then we'll discuss on some important themes which comes in this section. Okay.
Om Jnana Tivirandasya Jnana Jnana Shalabhaya Chakshurum Vritam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurudeva Shri Chaitanya Mano Vishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Svartam Vritam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Kadamayam Shri Guru Vaishnavam Shri Rupam Sakra Jatam Sahagana Raghunatam Vitantam Sriyam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanyam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Raghunatam Shri Vishatam Vitamsha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Peshaya Udale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Nami Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharini Nidhi Vishesha Shunyavadi Pashtatya Deshatarini Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namahe Gurudase Nama He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Veera Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kancha Radha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Mukam Kavati Vacharam Tangam Nangayati Kripatam
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya
Narayanam Namaskritya
Nashtaprayeshu
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhaktir Bhavati Nishtiki
Bhaktir Bhavati Nishtiki
Krishnaya Vasudevaya
Krishnaya Vasudevaya
Devaki Nandanaya Cha
Devaki Nandanaya Cha
Maraya
can open this shloka 10, 50 to 18. Can you make the alignment proper? This is the beginning of the section of Rukmiṇī's pastime with Krishna. So Parishit Maharaj is asking a question to Sudhya Goswami regarding this pastime of Krishna's marriage with Rukmiṇī. So we'll read that verse.
Shri Raja Vacha
Shri Raja Vacha
Bhagavan Bhishma Kasutam
Bhagavan Bhishma Upayema iti shrutam.
Upayema iti shrutam.
Sri Raja Vacha.
Sri Raja Vacha.
Bhagavan Bhishmakasutam.
Bhagavan Bhishmakasutam.
Rukmiṇī Ruchiranana.
Rukmiṇī Ruchiranana.
Rakshasena Vidhanena.
Rakshasena Vidhanena.
Upayema iti shrutam.
Upayema iti shrutam.
Sri Raja Vacha. Bhagavan Bhishmakasutam.
Bhagavan Bhishmakasutam.
Rukmiṇī Ruchiranaram.
Rakshasena Vidhanena. Upayema iti Shrutam.
Bhagavan Bhishmakasutam.
Rukmiṇī Ruchiranaram.
Rakshasena Vidhanena.
Upayema iti Shrutam.
Sri Raja Vacha.
Bhagavan Bhishmakasutam.
Rukmiṇī Ruchiranaram.
Rakshasena Vidhanena. Upayema iti Shrutam.
Sri Raja Vacha. The King Parikshit Maharaj said,
Bhagavan, the Supreme Lord,
Bhishmakasutam,
the daughter of Bhishmaka,
Rukmiṇī, Srimati Rukmiṇī Devi,
Ruchira,
Charming. Ananam,
whose face,
Rakshasena, called Rakshasa,
Vidhanena,
by the method,
namely kidnapping.
Upayeme,
he married.
Iti, thus,
Shrutam,
heard. King Parikshit said, the Supreme Lord married Rukmiṇī, the beautiful faced daughter of Bhishmaka, in the Rakshasa style. Or so I have heard. Srila Sridhar Swami quotes the following Smriti statement: Rakshaso Yuddha Haranat. A Rakshasa marriage takes place when the bride is stolen from one's rival suitors by force. Similarly, Shukadeva Goswami himself has already said, Rajna Pramathya, Krishna had to beat down opposing kings to take Rukmiṇī. So this is the beginning of this pastime of Krishna and Rukmiṇī. I'll just give you a little background of what has happened till now. So Krishna, yesterday morning, Srila Srinidhi was very nice to describe him. He appeared in Mathura, in the jail, and from the jail he was transported to Vrindavan, not Vrindavan, Gokul. So he was transported across the Yamuna, he went to Gokul, and he stayed there and performed many wonderful pastimes in his childhood, like killing of Putana and Nalakura Manikriva, deliverance of the two Yamarajas in the trees, stealing butter, eating mud and showing entire Brahmanda in his stomach. So that all pastimes he did.
Kalinga Mardana.
So many pastimes he did in Gokul. But then after some time, Nanda Maharaj and his brothers, they thought that it is not a very safe place. Let's go to a new place where it will be safe. So from Gokul, which comes in Mahavan, over the Gulf Forest, Gokul is in Mahavan. So then they shifted to Vrindavan, and so they went in a big caravan transporting all the luggage and everything, entire pura ghar shift kar diya, and they stayed in Vrindavan for the rest of the time, till up to 11 years when Krishna was about 11 years old. So then there in Vrindavan, Krishna performed further pastimes of killing of other demons and lifting Govardhan hill, and so many other pastimes of with the gopis and gopas happened in Vrindavan. So actually, Vrindavan is the most holiest of the whole, all holy places. Rupa Goswami, in Nectar of Instruction, has written, Vaikuntha Janito Vara Madhupuri Tatrapi Rasotsavan. So among all the Vaikuntha planets, Mathura is the topmost. Vaikuntha Janita Vara Madhupuri Tatrapi Rasotsavan Vrindaranyam Udara Pani Ramanath. So why Vrindavan is, and in Mathura, Vrindavan is topmost because in Vrindavan, Krishna has personally performed pastimes by keeping his feet and by walking. It is said that when Krishna walks in Vrindavan, his lotus footprints come on the land of Vrindavan. And all the thunderbolt, the lotus and all the insignia of Krishna's feet are imprinted on the land of Vrindavan. So Vrindavan is very, very fortunate. Vrindaranyam Udara Pani Ramanath Tatrapi Govardhana. And in Vrindavan, the topmost place is Govardhan, where Krishna further performed more intimate pastimes. And in Govardhan, there is a place called Radhakund, which is considered to be the topmost, because it is nothing but the liquid prema, Krishna prema, which is staying in Radhakund. So like this, the acharyas have described that among the different places in the entire creation, this Vrindavan is very, very famous, very fortunate. And Krishna has performed a lot of intimate pastimes in Vrindavan. So Krishna stayed in Vrindavan for up to 11 years and then he moved to Mathura. Actually, Krishna never keeps his feet out of Vrindavan. So Vrindavan Krishna was still in Vrindavan in unmanifest form and deeply residing in the core of the hearts of his devotees. But Vasudev Krishna, he went to Mathura to perform further pastimes. And in Mathura, he did the pastime of killing of Kamsa. So Kamsa was the leader among all the Rakshasas at that time. He was so powerful that he had conquered many other demons like Baka, Palamba, Agha, Putana, and so many people. And he had such control over them that whenever he called them, they came for his service. So powerful was Kamsa. And in his previous life, he was a demon called Kalanimi. And he was a grandson of Hiranyakashipu. So he was the son of Hiranyakashipu. And his grandsons, Hiranyakashipu's grandsons were the six sons who were killed by Kamsa. Because they were cursed that he would be killed by your own father. So that's what happened. So one by one, the six children were killed. And then finally, Krishna appeared. And then he went to Vrindavan and he came back to Mathura. And then in Mathura, he killed Kamsa. So after Kamsa was killed in Mathura, Jarasandha became very violent. Because Kamsa and Jarasandha were related. Jarasandha was father-in-law of Kamsa. Jarasandha's two daughters were given in marriage to Kamsa. When Kamsa was killed, these two daughters, they were very pained in the heart and they went and complained to Jarasandha. Jarasandha became furious and he collected huge akshayanis of army and he was attacking Mathura. It is said that Jarasandha attacked, every time Jarasandha attacked Mathura, Krishna and Balaram used to come and fight with Jarasandha and they will kill the entire army except Jarasandha. As Prabhu was mentioning today morning, the difference between Ram Leela and Krishna Leela. In Krishna Leela, demons came to Krishna and Krishna killed them. But in Ram Leela, Lord Ram went searching for demons and he killed them. He went to Dandakaranya and searched for the demons and he killed them. He went to Ravana, searched for Ravana and killed him. So like this he performed his pastimes. So Krishna was killing everybody except Jarasandha. And he will leave him. And Jarasandha will feel very insulted, very angry. Because for Kshatriya, insulting is worse than death. So they are ready to die and tolerate the pain of death, but they cannot tolerate insult. So Jarasandha will go back, hanging his head down, then again collect a huge Akshvanis of army and again attack. So like this, Krishna defeated Jarasandha 17 times. And Jarasandha had to go back. And the 18th time in Jarasandha attack, he attacked with 23 Akshvahini Sena. Really huge army. In Kurukshetra battle, it was 18 Akshvahini. Pandavas were right, 7 and Kauravas were 11. But here, 23 Akshvahini single Jarasandha is bringing and he attacked. So when he attacked, Krishna thought it's becoming too much. So let's not fight, let's do something else. We have many other priorities to attend to. Why to waste time fighting with Jarasandha? So they start running away. As if he is fearful of Jarasandha. And Jarasandha was surprised. Oh, Krishna is getting afraid of me. So let me run behind him and capture him and kill him. Like that he was thinking. So this is what demons think. Demons think that they can capture and kill Krishna. Even Hiranyakashipu had the same mentality. Hiranyakashipu was thinking, yeah, Vishnu may be powerful, but I can capture him and I'll kill him and I'll drink his blood. So that was the mentality of Asuras. Asuras know Lord is powerful, but they think they can kill him and they can become God. The Asuri mentality. So Jarasandha was chasing Krishna and Balaram, and Krishna and Balaram were running on their bare foot. It is described that Krishna's feet are very soft, but with that soft feet, Krishna travelled a long distance. They went many yojanas, many yojanas. One yojana is almost 8 miles. So they travelled many yojanas, and they and many chariots and foot soldiers, they were chasing Krishna and Balaram. And Krishna and Balaram climbed on a very tall mountain, so which came on the way. So that mountain's name was Parvarshana. So this huge mountain was there. And this mountain was very, very tall, several yojanas high. Yeah, so two of them, actually it was 11 yojanas high. It's mentioned here. 11 yojanas. So how many kilometers it is? 88 miles. Into 1.6. 141 kilometers tall mountain. So we don't have experience of such a mountain right now in Kali Yuga. But in the previous Dwapara Yuga, the mountains were much higher. Tallest mountain you can find right now is Mount Everest. It is about 8 kilometers. So Krishna climbed on this mountain, which was 141 kilometers high. And from there, Krishna and Balaram, they jumped. They had a high jump. It was a really high jump. And what Jarasandha did, even prior to Krishna and Balaram jumping, so Jarasandha, he had sent all the soldiers to search in this mountain where Krishna and Balaram are hiding. So when they went, they could not find. So Jarasandha thought, put fire to this mountain. So this 141 kilometer tall mountain was put on fire. They put all the dry grasses, wood and everything, and they put fire. Jarasandha was thinking, now Krishna and Balaram will be surely dead. But they did not know that Krishna and Balaram jumped top of the mountain and nothing happened. And the verse says, Tata utpatya tarasa dahyamana tatat ubhav dashaika yojanat tungan. Dasha eka means ekadasha, 11 yojanas. Nipetatur ado bhuvi, it fell on the ground. And unseen alakshamana ripuna, unseen by his enemies, Samugena Yaduttamo, Krishna along with his brother Balaram Sopuram Punarayatam. Again they came back to Mathura. Here Jarasandha thought that Krishna and Balaram are dead and he went back. And Krishna and Balaram they went back to Dwaraka, not to Mathura. So prior to this what happened? Krishna, after Jarasandha attacked 17 times, Krishna thought it's not a safe place, so let me relocate from Mathura to a new place. So he created a manifested a city overnight. It's overnight construction project. He built thousands of palaces and buildings, relationship places, lakes, gardens, and he even got the Sudharma Rajya Sabha from Indraloka, put it there. And this was a city constructed like an island in the ocean. It was not built on land. It was built in the middle of the Arabian Sea, next to Dwarka. The current Dwarka, Gujarat, that city is there. Now the Dwarka city is there in the border, near the ocean, but actual city is inside. And the Mahabharata describes that there is a bridge connecting Dwarka city with the mainland. And there are many check posts. And the guards used to check all the people going, coming and going. And all the bona fide residents of Dwarka had to carry a mudra, which had a sign of an animal with three heads. So that was a mudra they had to carry. So then only they began access into the city. So Krishna created a very protective fort for all the residents of Mathura. And they transported everybody there overnight. So after transporting, he went back to Mathura to fight with Jarasandha. And then in between, he didn't even start fighting, but he felt there is a very important job to do, more important than killing Jarasandha. So that will be the Rukmini's letter which is coming. So Krishna thought, protecting my devotee and being with my devotee and giving happiness to devotee is more important than fighting and killing Jarasandha, so he came back. This is described in 10th canto, one of the verses. Bhajate tadrishi krida yah shrutva tatparo bhavet. Why Krishna comes to this material world? To perform wonderful pastimes with his devotees, to give happiness to his devotees, by discussing which the hearers of Bhagavatam will get purified. He comes here to give some subject material for devotees to discuss. Bhajate tadrishi krida. So this is the 10:33:66. Anugrahaya bhaktanam manushum dehamasthitah. Bhajate tadrishi krida.
Bhajate tadrishi krida.
Yashrutva tatparo bhavet.
Yashrutva tatparo bhavet.
Anugrahaya bhaktanam. Being very compassionate or merciful on his devotees. Manusham deham asthita. He comes and he appears like an ordinary human being. And he performs krida. Krida means pastimes. As if an ordinary human being is doing. And by hearing which, yah shrutva tat paro bhavet. Those who hear these pastimes of Krishna, they will become transcendental. They will become divine. Because these pastimes of Krishna are transcendental. So that's the benediction. And we have Srimad Bhagavatam, 18,000 shlokas. And if we discuss one shloka per day, it will take how many years? 50 years. So devotees can go on discussing for 50 years Srimad Bhagavatam. So whole life will be over. Yeah, Shrutva? Transcendental, you go back and back to God. So that's the main reason why Krishna comes to this material world. So he went, he ran away. Jarasandha mistakenly thought that Balaram and Kesava had burned to death in fire. Thus he withdrew his vast military force and returned to Magadha kingdom. So Jarasandha stays in Magadha. So where is current Magadha? Bihar. So, few years back, I had gone to a place called Rajgir. It's near Nalanda. From Patna, we went to Nalanda University. It was one of the biggest universities. Now, nothing is remaining. Just some foundation stones are remaining, that's all. The entire university is lost. From Nalanda, we went to Rajgir. That's the place that was the capital of Magadha Desh. And Jarasandha was the ruling personality there. So many demons were staying there at that time. So then Parikshit Maharaj mentions, Shrita Goswami mentions that Balaram married Revati, son of Revata mountain, and Krishna married Rukmini. So it was from Vidarbha. So Vidarbhi, Rukmini is also called as Vidarbhi. So this Vidarbha Desh comes in Maharashtra near Nagpur area, so Kaundinyapur. There's a place called Kaundinyapur. So that is the exact place where Rukmini was staying. So he just mentioned this. But Parikshit Maharaj was so eager to hear Krishna Katha that he mentions this verse. The Supreme Lord married Rukmini, the beautiful faced daughter of Bhishmaka in the Rakshasa style. I have heard. Then he says, "My Lord, I wish to hear how the immeasurably powerful Lord Krishna took away his bride while defeating such kings as Magadha and Shalva." Because there are many kings like Jarasandha, Shalva, Shishupala, Tantavakra, and so many other allies. They had all come for Rukmini's marriage, and Krishna comes and takes Rukmini in between all of them. So Parikshit was very eager to hear. What experienced listener, O Brahmana, could ever grow satiated by listening to the pious chanting and ever fresh topics of Lord Krishna, which cleanse away the world's contamination? So very interesting. The Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, 52nd chapter. So Parikshit Maharaj had only 7 days. And 10th canto discussion began on the 4th day. And maybe for 2.5 days, this, I'm not sure, but because it has about 90 chapters, we can easily guess that the discussion must have gone for further over 2.5 to 3 days. So almost 5th day, you can say, Parikshit Maharaj, without drinking a drop of water, without eating anything, and without a moment of sleep, for 5 days and 5 nights, he has continuously heard Srimad Bhagavatam. And then he is speaking this verse. What experienced listener, O Brahmana, could ever grow satiated by listening to the topics, pious, charming, by listening to the pious, charming and ever fresh topics of Lord Krishna? Means he is asking, please tell me more in detail, don't cut short these pastimes. I want to hear in detail about this pastime, so please explain it. So then Sukadeva Goswami, he starts narrating the pastime of he goes to the kingdom of Bhishmaka. So here he is telling, Sri Bhadarani Ruvacha, Raja Asit Bhishmako Nama. There is a king called Bhishmaka. Vaidarbha Adipati Mahan, and he was the Adipati of Vidarbha Desh. So Vidarbha Desh, as I told you, comes in Maharashtra, the northern part of Maharashtra. Tasya Panchabhav Putraha, he had 5 sons. Kanyakacha Varanana, and he had a daughter who had a very beautiful face, Varanana. So 5 brothers and 1 sister, so that is the family. So the 5 brothers' names are mentioned here. Rukmi Agrajo, so Rukmi was the eldermost among all of them. Rukmaratho, Rukmabahu, Anantara, Rukmakesha, Rukmamali. So Rukmi, Rukmaratha, Rukmabahu, Rukmakesha, Rukmamali. So these are the 5 brothers. And Rukmini, Esha Swasas Satihi. So she was the sister of these five. So in Sanskrit, the word for sister is Swasa or Swastra. So it matches with even English, sister, Swastra. Daughter, Duhitra. Matru, mother. Pitru, father. So many of the words are coming from Sanskrit. So even the, not only the Indian languages, but even the English language has many commonalities between Sanskrit. So from this we can understand that Sanskrit is the mother language of all the languages. And in fact, it's also proven that Vedic culture was existing everywhere throughout the planet. I was reading one diary of Indradhanu Maharaj. I don't know how many of you have read. So Maharaj was in easternmost part of Russia, near Korea, which is next to Japan, that area. So then the devotees there, they had arranged for a meeting with one of the top philosophers or scholars in that area. So he was a HOD of a university. So Maharaj went there to meet him. And Maharaj was thinking what this person will know about Vaishnavism and Vedic culture. So he just asked him a question. Do you know about Vedic culture something? And that scholar started talking a lot about Vedic culture. He said, you follow Vedas, and you particularly, you are a Vaishnava, and you worship Vishnu, and you especially follow Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, and you read Srimad Bhagavatam. And he started telling a lot about Vedic culture. And Maharaj was amazed, how do you know so much about this? Then he said, I take special interest in Vedic culture. So I have read a lot of Vedas myself. And he said that we have a Russian Veda. We have a book called Russian Veda, which contains story similar to Krishna's story. So there is a nice village, and there is a boy who had superhuman powers, and he killed a lot of demons in his childhood, and he performed many sweet pastimes. They have a Russian Veda which contains stories like this. And Maharaj is amazed by this. And that Russian scholar, he said that I have full conviction that this Vedic culture was there in this part of Russia long, long ago, but over a period of time, it is lost. So that is very eye-opening to Maharaj. Maharaj said, it's wonderful. I'll meet you again, and I have fixed an appointment to discuss further. And it is also said that Russia is a place of rishis, where a lot of sages used to stay. And there are a lot of people do a lot of austerities in Russia. So it goes to show that Vedic culture is there everywhere, and even the language, the root language is coming from Sanskrit. So Rukmiṇī was a sister. Hearing of the beauty, prowess, transcendental character and opulence of Mukunda from visitors to the palace who sang his praises, Rukmiṇī decided that he would be the perfect husband for her. So, in the palace of Vidarbha, Bhishmaka, many great sages like Narada Muni and other sages used to come, and they used to discuss Krishna Katha. And they tell the different pastimes of Krishna. And Rukmiṇī also heard these pastimes. And after hearing these pastimes, she decided that if anybody is going to be my husband, it will be Krishna only. And she had already given her heart to Krishna. So later on, one shloka will come where we will more focus on this theme of how by hearing about Krishna, one develops attraction for Krishna. And that's the first shloka which Rukmiṇī writes in her letter to Krishna. It's a very beautiful verse. So we'll come to that shloka and we'll discuss more about this point of hearing about Krishna. And especially Krishna's form. So Lord, can somebody read this translation?
Lord Krishna knew that Rukmiṇī possessed intelligence, auspicious bodily markings, magnanimity, beauty, proper behavior and all the qualities. Concluding that she she would be an ideal wife for him. He made up his mind to marry her.
Yeah, so even Krishna also heard about Rukmini and he also decided that she will be my wife. And in one sense, Rukmini and Krishna, they are both like Lakshmi and Narayana. So they are eternally consorts. They are eternally married to each other. And Lakshmi Devi is none other than the internal potency of Krishna. So there cannot be any separation between Krishna and Rukmini in one sense. Why? Because they are eternally united with each other. But why they perform such pastime wherein they act as if they don't know each other and as if they heard about each other, develop attraction and then they get married. This is the pastime. It is called as Leela. Right. Few days back I was discussing Samudra Manthan. So when Samudra Manthan is happening, from the Manthan, one of the items which comes out from the ocean is what? Lakshmi Devi comes out. Not just nectar, Lakshmi also comes. And when Lakshmi comes, Samudra Manthan stops for some time. He says that some people are very austere, but they have fault. The fault is they become angry. Right? Some people are very rich, but the fault is they may not be willing to give charity, they are not compassionate. So like this she lists about 12 qualities and 12 disqualifications. So these are qualified people but they have some disqualification. Then she, by the process of elimination, she eliminates everybody. And then finally she comes to Lord Narayana. Yes, he is perfect. He is the only person who is all perfect, he has no faults. So if somebody has to be my husband, he only has to be my husband. But then she thinks and says, he also has a fault. What is that fault? The fault is, he is not attracted to me. Because Lord is called Atma Rama. He is self-satisfied. A self-satisfied person does not require anybody. He does not require anything. Right? So nowadays, people are crazy about purchasing things. This is the world of consumerism. Jo consume karke marta hai, usko bolte consumer. There is another word called customer. Jo kasht karke marta hai, usko bolte customer. This is the world of consumerism because people are mad after shopping. They go to a mall and get so many things, right? As Chaitanya Chandrapur says it, people purchase things that they don't need with the money which they don't have to impress things whom they don't love. You understood the point? People nowadays purchase things which they don't need with the money which they don't have, credit card, to impress people whom they don't love. So that is the kind of world we are living in. Right? We don't need so many things, but the advertisements bombard. Purchase this, you'll be happy. Take this, you'll be happy. So this is the world of advertisements and people are forced to purchase things against their will. And their home gets filled up with articles which they hardly use. Isn't it? So that happens. So simple life keeps one's mind very cool. So that's why Srila Prabhupada used to advocate, live a very simple life, take things which are minimum basic required like that. So because we are not Atmaram, we think if I get some item, I'll be complete. But when you get purchase some item, you'll find something better than that, and you want that. So there's no end to this. So that someone should be satisfied. So Lord is the most satisfied person. He doesn't need anybody, not even Lakshmi. But Lakshmi says what to do, you know. So she takes the garland, she says he is the most perfect person. And by serving him, I'll be satisfied. So just like when you decorate yourself, your reflection in the mirror also gets decorated. Prahlad Maharaj uses analogy.
says, if you want to be happy, you decorate Krishna. Like today morning, devotees are decorating Krishna so wonderfully, putting all the dots and making turban and garlands. It takes so much time and energy to make all this, and also devotion. So when you decorate Krishna, we become satisfied. When you work hard for Krishna, we become satisfied, we become happy. So then Lakshmi Devi takes the garland and puts on Lord Narayana. Similarly, here also, Rukmini and Krishna, they are performing the pastime of their marriage just to relish, it's a leela, just to relish themselves and also so that the other devotees can also hear about it and discuss and get purified. So that's what we are doing. Even after 5,000 years, we are discussing, sitting here, hearing about Rukmini's pastime. But the problem was, Rukmi was envious of Lord Krishna. Rukmi was envious of Lord Krishna and he did not want. And because he was the elder brother, he had some control. And even Bhishmaka could not go against him. So Bhishmaka is compared to the intelligence which is weak. If the intelligence is weak, then the mind takes over. One may not do the right action. One may get bewildered and may do the wrong action. Just like Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra is father and Duryodhana is son. So Dhritarashtra is the king and Duryodhana is not even the king, he is a prince. But Duryodhana had taken full control because Dhritarashtra was weak-minded because of his material attachment. So here Bhishmaka, he was weak, so Rukmi took advantage and he fixed the marriage of Rukmini with Shishupala, who was also envious of Krishna, the most envious person. Shishupala, it is said that as soon as he was born, the words coming out of his mouth were blasphemy of Krishna. He was blaspheming. And the astrologer said that anybody who picks him up, and Shishupala had four hands, and mother was astonished, why four hands? And the astrologer said that anybody who picks him up, at that time the two hands will disappear, that person will become the cause of his death. So when Krishna came and picked Shishupala, two hands went off, then she understood, he is going to be the cause of my son's death. So at that time, she begged, kindly, don't kill him. And Krishna said, but he will insult me, I cannot tolerate. But she still begged, no? Please don't kill my son. Then Krishna put a promise. Made a promise that, okay, I'll not kill. But if he does 100 blasphemies, then I cannot tolerate, I'll kill him. So many times when Krishna encountered Shishupala, Krishna forgave him and Shishupala did not reach 100. He could not hit a century. But in that Rajasvi Yajna, said that time, Krishna waited patiently when that 100 will come. As soon as Shishupala touched 100 blasphemies, Krishna released his chakra and killed Shishupala. So that is one connection between Shishupala and Krishna. So Rukmi arranged the marriage with Shishupala. And he also contacted Jarasandha, and Jarasandha arranged a huge army for security. They all came, and those marriage celebrations are happening in the kingdom and everywhere. Wonderful arrangements were made, right? So, but Rukmini was very, very unhappy with this decision because she had already given her heart to Krishna, like that. So at that time, Rukmini wonders, what should I do now? I am helpless, I cannot go away from here because Rukmi is there and many other soldiers are there, I cannot escape. So she called one Brahmana, a very trustworthy Brahmana. So verse number 26, yeah. So dark-eyed Vaidarbhi was aware of his plan and deeply upset her. Analyzing the situation, she quickly sent a trustworthy Brahmana to Krishna. And this Brahmana, see, Vidarbha is in Maharashtra and Dwarka is in Gujarat. He goes very fast, very swiftly he goes to Dwarka and meets Krishna there. And Dwarka was such a place that Krishna had given an order to all the security guards. If any Brahmana comes, you should not object. Right, straight away send him to my palace, where I am. Even when Sudama went to meet Krishna, it is said that none of the guards stopped him. Although he was not very good looking, shabby clothes, torn dhoti and all, nobody stopped him because it was Krishna's order. So from this you'll understand that how much importance Krishna gave to his devotees. Nobody could stop them. But if any opposing elements were there, then guards used to take care. But when this Brahmana came, he directly went to meet Krishna and he met Krishna who was sitting on a golden throne. So then see how Krishna receives this Brahmana. Krishna, the Lord of the Rounds, came down from his throne and seated him. Krishna came down and he made Brahmana sit on the throne. Then the Lord worshipped him just as he himself is worshipped by the demigods. Means what? He took all the arti paraphernalia. Dhupa, Deepa, Pushpa, Gandha, Arghya, and he washed the feet of this Brahmana and did such wonderful worship. Right. Same paraphernalia with which you worship Krishna, Krishna uses the same paraphernalia to worship his devotees. So from this we understand that how much importance Krishna is giving to his devotees. When Sudama was being worshipped by Krishna, all the residents in the palace, they are amazed. Who is this Brahmana? That Krishna is washing his feet and Rukmini is fanning. Right. This comes in the later chapter, 80th chapter of Bhagavatam, this Sudama pastime comes. And everybody is amazed. Such a fortunate personality is this Sudama. How dear he must be to Krishna that Krishna is personally reciprocating like this. So from this we understand that how much importance we should give to other devotees and not take them very casually. Right. So Krishna is setting an example here. Right. By personally washing the feet of his devotees. In the Rajasvi Yajna of Yudhishthira Maharaj, all the people took services. Right? Different people. Bhima took care of cooking. Right? And Yudhishthira Maharaj, Vidura, I think Vidura was taking care of finances. And Duryodhana was taking care of gift reception. Many kings are coming, they are giving gifts. And Duryodhana's duty was to find out the value and the name of the gift and write it. And more gifts are coming, Duryodhana's envy was increasing. Then he was saying, hey, Yudhishthira is growing richer than me. Because Duryodhana knew what is his wealth in Hastinapur, and here Yudhishthira is becoming richer. His envy, he could not tolerate. So at that time, Krishna had taken one service. What was Krishna's service? He washing the feet of all the guests who are coming there. He voluntarily took that service. So this shows that how doing humble menial services is very, Krishna is showing by his own example that how not just one should do white collar services, but even cleaning services, washing the feet of his devotees and doing all menial services like that. That's what is very pleasing to Krishna. So here also Krishna worships this Brahmana very wonderfully. So then Krishna does Atithi Satkar. There is a proper sequence in which one has to do Satkar. So Krishna offered the Brahmana nice eatables to eat, and he massaged the feet of the Brahmana with his own hands. He massaged the feet and then he made him take some rest, and then he asked questions. He inquired, and this inquiry is very interesting. A especially for devotees. So kindly recite this verse. This section of about 3 verses, 30, 31, 32, 33 and 34, that 5 verses tell us that what should be the quality of a real Brahmana. And Krishna says, I am pleased when the Brahmanas are developing such qualities. That's what he says. And one of the main important themes of this verses is satisfaction. That a Brahmana should be satisfied. If he is not satisfied, he cannot develop Brahmanical qualities. That's what is mentioned here. Kacchit dvijavara
sreshtha
dharmaste
vriddha
sattamaha vartate nati krichrena santushta manasasadah. The Supreme Lord said, oh, best of the exalted Brahmanas, are your religious practices sanctioned by the senior authorities proceeding without great difficulty? Is your mind always fully satisfied, santushta? So this is the inquiry he is doing. So generally the Brahmanas are supposed to do 6 duties. Patan Patan means reading and teaching. Studying and teaching. Yajan, Yajan, performing Yajna, or in Kali Yuga it means Sankirtan. Yajan, Yajan, doing Sankirtan and engaging others in Sankirtan. And Dana, Pratigraham, accepting charity and giving charity. These are the 6 duties of a Brahmana. So the Lord is asking, is everything all right? Are you able to do these 6 duties without any difficulty? And are you satisfied in your mind of your material situation? Are you satisfied? That is the question. If you read Krishna book, Srila Prabhupada is writing there that when you meet a person, you should ask the right inquiry. Yes, Krishna is meeting a Brahmana. He is asking these questions. He is not asking how is your business going on, are your citizens obeying you. He is asking relevant questions. Suppose you meet a Kshatriya, an administrator or a politician. What do you ask? Is your treasury full? Are your citizens listening to you? Is your army strong enough? These are the questions you ask when you meet a Kshatriya. And when you meet a Vaishya, a businessman, how is your business transaction going on? Are you in profit? Is the market fine? Like the relevant questions you ask. So Krishna is asking relevant questions and teaching us how we should also inquire when you meet the opposite. When you meet some person, you should ask the relevant questions. Santushto yarhi varteta Brahmano yena kena chet.
Brahmano yena kena chet.
Ahiyamana swadharmat. Sahyasya kila kamadhuk.
Sahyasya kila kamadhuk.
See, when a Brahman is satisfied with whatever comes his way and does not fall away from his religious duties, those very religious principles become his desire cow, fulfilling all his wishes. So, santushto yena kena chit. Means a Brahmana should be satisfied in every situation. If he has all the wealth, he should be satisfied. And if he has no wealth, still he should be satisfied. That's the quality of a true Brahmana. He is not greedy for material progress. Because Brahmana means Brahma Janati iti Brahmana. One who knows Krishna, he is Brahmana. One who knows Brahman, Supreme Brahman. Right? So nowadays in India, it has become a kind of this thing that anybody born in a Brahman family, he is called as a Brahmana. Anybody born in a Kshatriya family is called a Kshatriya or a Vaishya. The caste name comes from birth. But that is not the actual system. The actual system is based on guna and karma. If he is having the qualities of a brahmana, he should be called as a brahmana. It doesn't go by janma. Krishna doesn't say janma karma vibhagasha. He says guna karma vibhagasha. So one of the qualities of a brahmana is he is satisfied. And another thing is brahmana doesn't do a job for money. He does service, and whatever comes as charity, that only he takes and lives by that. So, for example, Sudama, he was not doing any job. His only duty is patan patan ajan ajan. Right? And a time came when he had nothing in his home, not even anything to eat. At that time, wife requested, you go and ask something from Krishna. At that time, Sudama thinks, I should carry some gift to Krishna. Then he asks his wife, is there any gift in home to carry? Wife says, in our home we have nothing but four walls. She didn't say that, but something like that. We have nothing. And she checks, something should be there. She had nothing. And acharyas say that she went and begged some poha, some flat rice. She brought it and wrapped it in a best piece of cloth they had in their home and gave it to Sudama. Please take this. So Sudama, even in that situation, he was satisfied. When wife gave the idea that go and meet Krishna, he didn't become excited. Oh, very good idea, I'll go and ask some money from him. He became excited because it was a chance to meet Krishna. Oh, since long time, I have not met him. We are friends together in Gurukul, in Sandipani Muni's ashram. And we passed out and we are in different places. It's a good chance to meet Krishna. Let me go and talk to Krishna. See, he went with that intention. And even after going to Dwarka, he did not even think about asking this, that give some money. No. He just went, Krishna served him, talked to him, then he came back. So, but Krishna reciprocated in such a way that he became so rich. But even when he became rich, he never forgot Krishna. So that is the meaning of a brahmana. So he is satisfied in all situations. Then Krishna says, Asantushto sakrallokan Napnotyapi Sureshwaraha Akinchanopi Santushtaha Shete Sarvanga Vijwaraha. Can somebody read?
An unsatisfied brahmana wanders restlessly from one planet to another. Even if he becomes king of heaven, but a satisfied brahmana, though he may possess nothing, rests peacefully all his limbs free of distress.
Yeah, if the brahmana's mind is restless because of material agitation, he cannot be happy anywhere. Even if he gets heaven, he cannot be happy there. So that's why a brahmana should be satisfied in whatever situation he is in. So that's what Krishna is instructing this brahmana also. Can you read the next also translation?
I repeatedly bow my head in respect to those brahmanas who are satisfied with their lot. Saintly, prideless, peaceful, they are the best
well-wishers of all living beings. Yeah. So Krishna is telling, I put my head at the feet of such brahmanas who are satisfied. So you can imagine this. So calling oneself brahman is not a very ordinary thing. Right? It is a very exalted thing. And Krishna is giving such position to brahmana. So then Krishna asks, what is the matter? You have come here. So then brahmana says that, no, Rukmiṇī has sent a letter and this is the letter, please take this. Krishna says, you only read it. No, see, Rukmiṇī had sent this letter wrapped and brahmana also had not read it till then. He didn't know what is there inside. And Krishna is telling, you read it. It means what? Krishna trusts so much his devotees. So even when this person knows, it will be confidential because it will be only between two people. So much trust Krishna has on his devotees. And then the brahmana starts reading the letter of Rukmiṇī. which starts from verse number 37. So verse number 37 onwards, for about 7 verses, describe the letter of Rukmiṇī, which she had personally written to Krishna. And this is a very heart-touching and very wonderful things. We'll spend some considerable time discussing, especially the first verse and the last verse of this letter. So, you are comfortable with Devanagari? Shri Rukmiṇī Vācha. Shrutva gunan bhuvana sundara shrunvatam te. Nirvishyakarna vivarair harutungatapam. Rupam drisham drishimatam akhilarthalabham. Tvayachuta vishati chitta matap apatrapamme. It's a very beautiful verse. We'll recite it 2 more times. And you can try to memorize this also. Those who like shlokas, it's a feast for you. Shrutva gunan bhuvana sundara shrunvatam te. Nirvishya karna vivarair harutungatapam. Rupam drisham drishimatam akhilarthalabham. Tvayachuta vishati chittam apatrapamme. Shrutva gunan bhuvana sundara shrunvatam te. Nirvishya karna vivarair harutungatapam. Rupam drisham drishimatam akhilarthalabham. Tvayachuta vishati chittam apatrapamme. So this shloka, she's telling, Shrutva Gunan. Shrutva means hearing, Gunan means qualities. Of whom? Bhuvana Sundara. Of the most beautiful personality in the entire creation, who is Krishna. So Krishna is called here as Bhuvana Sundara. Shrunvatamte means after hearing his qualities. Through Nirvishya Karna Vivarehi. Karna means ears. So when your qualities, glories of your qualities entered my ears, and from here they went to the heart. And completely Harata Angatapam, they completely removed my bodily pains or anxieties. Because in this world we are always troubled by tapatraya. Right? Tapa, harata anga tapam. Tapam means pains, miseries. Adhyatmika, adhibhautika, adhidaivika. So these three are called as tapatraya. Three problems. Right? Recently in Karnataka, the heavy rain. It's one tapatraya. Which is in which category? Adhidaivika klesha. Because natural calamities, no? We cannot do anything about it. No matter how much our money we spend, we cannot do anything about it. Water just flows. Sometimes earthquakes come, sometimes many other calamities come. Sometimes hot summer, there is drought, and there is too much heavy rain in the rainy season. So, adi daivika klesha. Adi bhautika. Adi bhautika means sufferings due to other living entities. Right? Dengue, malaria, all this is rampant. That adibhautika klesha. And adhyatmika klesha means suffering due to our own body and mind. So that's called adibhautika, adhyatmika klesha. So by hearing about Krishna from bona fide authorities, one can transcend the influence of these three kleshas. Right? Means he will not be affected by these troubles which come in his life. He will be transcendentally situated. Like great acharyas, although they are in their old age, like Srila Prabhupada, although he was so old, but still he was acting so young. Such energy, such preaching, such clarity of his thought. So this is all because of spiritual advancement. So by hearing about Krishna, one becomes free from all material miseries. Nirvishyakarana vivare harato angatapam. And third line describes beauty of Krishna. Rupam drisham drishamatam akhilartha labham. See, all of our senses have got a sense object. Eyes have got some form which they can see. Ears, the sense object is sound. For the tongue it is taste. For skin it is touch. For nose it is smell. So, shabda, sparsha, rasa, rupa, gandha. So, for all the senses there are sense objects. Similarly, for those who wish to see something beautiful, Rukmiṇī is saying there is nothing more beautiful than your form to see. It's the most beautiful form in the entire creation. Rupam, drisham, drishimatam, akhilartha labham. So Prabhupada translates as, your beauty which fulfills all the visual desires of those who see. Right? See, nowadays people go to hill stations, waterfalls, and they want to take selfies and photos so that they have memories, because they go to beautiful places. Wherever they go, they want to find a place to take a selfie. So that's the culture nowadays. Because that means what? People have something, some inclination to see some beautiful things. But the most beautiful thing in this world is Krishna's eternal beauty. All the things in this world, they're all temporary. Even the waterfalls or the mountains, right? They may be there for a couple of centuries, but after some time they're gone. Once pralaya happens, they're gone, right? So these are all temporary beauties, but the real beauty is Krishna's beauty. Tvai achyuta avishati chittam apatrapamme. And after hearing your beauty, I have shamelessly become attracted to you, O Krishna. Apatrapamme means shamelessly. Shamelessly, because she is writing this letter to Krishna, where she is also giving the action plan, how we should kidnap me. And shamelessly she is writing that letter, that I want to be your wife. So that is the meaning of this verse. And it also shows that Krishna's beauty is so attractive. And there are many, many verses in Bhagavatam describing Krishna's beauty. I recently read one shloka which comes in the section of the Brahmana's wife going to meet Krishna, when Krishna says, I am hungry. Krishna says, I am hungry. And he requests his gopas to go and get some food from the home. So at that time, they come rushing towards where Krishna is, shamelessly. But their husband stopped, their children stopped, please don't go. Still they carried all the, whatever they had made, samosas, jalebis, laddus and everything, they carried to Krishna. And they see Krishna at a distance. And the form is very, very interesting, the way Krishna is standing there. So it is said, so from this we will understand from this shloka how beautiful Krishna is looking. I'll take about three verses from Bhagavatam which describes Krishna's exquisite beauty, directly describing Krishna's form as Shyam Sundar. So when you are reading this verse, you can also see the deity. Shyamam Hiranyaparidhim Vanamalya Varha Dhatu Pravala Natavesham Anuvratamshe Vinyasta Hastamitarena So it is that Shyamam, Krishna's color is Shyamavarna, Megha Shyama, just like a thick black monsoon cloud. Hiranyaparidhim means golden dhoti. Hiranya means gold. So bright yellow dhoti Krishna is wearing. Vanamalya, he is wearing a garland made of forest flowers. So Krishna wears a particular garland which is called Vaijayanti. Sundara kundala nayana vishala galasahe Vaijayanti mala. So as we sang that song before the class, that says Vaijayanti mala means forest flower garland made of five different kinds of forest flowers. It's Vaijayanti. So and Barha, he is wearing a peacock, right? So Barha is a Sanskrit word for peacock feather. Dhatu pravala. So generally people like to put cosmetics nowadays. No? They put powder, many creams and this and that. But Krishna doesn't put any of that. In the Vrindavan, there are natural minerals and dust available from the Govardhan forest, Govardhan mountain. Krishna takes those dhatu and puts it on his face. And they put some dots by using the minerals and like that. So Krishna is also beautifully decorated with many dots. So that's how Krishna looks. Dhatu pravala. Natavesham. Natavesham means like a beautiful actor. So generally when you are going to act somewhere and you are going to come on stage as a king or whatever, you are acting in the capacity of whatever role you are playing, you come dressed very beautifully. Similarly, Krishna is also well dressed. So because Mother Yashoda in the morning takes time to dress Krishna properly, then sends him. So Natavesham, very expertly, very beautifully dressed. And Anuvratamshi. So Anuvrata, actually not Anuvrata, it is Anuvrata. So he is keeping the hand, Amsha means on the shoulder. So Krishna is keeping one hand on the shoulder of his friend. So the gopis are seeing this sight. Anuvrata Amsha Vinyasta Hastam. He has kept his hand. And Itrena, another hand, it's free. So he is holding a lotus, like this lotus which is hanging here. Not, it's paper lotus, but real lotus is holding and dhunanam abjam is whirling it, is rotating it like this. And then karana utpala in his ear, this place is there, no? Here Krishna is wearing some long flowers. Karana utpala alaka kapola. Alaka means the hair, curly hair. So curly locks of black hair are falling on his cheeks. And it's looking very attractive. Right? Same people in Hollywood also they copy. No? They put long hair and they try to make the hair come till their cheek. They're trying to copy Krishna. Alaka kapola mukabja hasam. And his smile is also very beautiful, like a open lotus flower, very beautiful lotus flower looks. So this is the wonderful beauty of Krishna, right? In Brahma Samhita also we sing how attractive Krishna looks. Venum kvananta maravinda dalayataksham barhavatam samasitam budasundarangam. Here also again Barha comes. Asitambuda means rain cloud. Ambudi means that which carries the rain. So which is the clouds, they carry the rainwater in the drop. Barhavatam samasitambuda sundarangam. Kandarpa koti kamani avishesha shobham.
Kandarpa koti kamani avishesha shobham.
And his beauty is like if you put 1 crore kandarpa. Kandarpa means cupid. Kamadev is very beautiful. And Kamadev's job is to take a sugarcane bow and a flower arrow and keep shooting at the hearts of people. So that's why whenever lovers, they draw a heart, no? They put an arrow also inside. Means what? Material love will cause pain eventually. The arrow is inevitable. So here he is taking the arrow and shooting. So if you keep 1 crore cupids on one side and Krishna on the other side, still they cannot match Krishna's beauty. Kandarpa koti kamaniya vishesha shobham govindam adi purusham tamaham bhajami. That's the beauty of Govinda, Sri Krishna. So this is the beauty of Krishna. And even Bhishma Dev sings one shloka which is very, very attractive. His favorite scene, which also describes Krishna's form. Right? So that comes in first canto. It's Tribhuvana Kamanam Tamala Varanam. What's happening? Tribhuvana Kamanam Tamala Varnam Ravikara Gauravarambharam Dadane Vapuralak Kulavratana Nabjam Vijaya Sakheratirastumena Vadya. Again, Tribhuvana Kavanam. So Rukmiṇī Deva is calling her as Bhuvana Sundaram. So here also Tribhuvana Kavanam. He is the most beautiful personality in all the three worlds. What are the three worlds? Bhurbhavasva. So they are the three worlds which are there. So in all the three worlds there is no beautiful personality as Sri Krishna. And what is this color? Tamala Varanam. So in the other stroke it is described as Megashyamam, but here it is Tamala Varanam. Tamal tree. How many of you have seen Tamal tree? Tamal tree. You can recognize. If you go to Vrindavan in Krishna Balaram Mandir, in the temple campus only, in the veranda of the temple, there is one tree, single tree standing, that is Tamal tree. So Krishna, that color of that tree is almost little bluish black. So that is the color of Krishna, Tamala Varanam. So Prabhupada personally planted that tree in Vrindavan long back. So and his color of his dress, Ravikara Gauravarambaram Dadane. Just like the rising sun, Ravikara Gauravarambaram. Ravikara means sunrise. Ravi is sun. So Gaura means like golden yellow color. Like when the sun is rising, you see one tinge of orange, golden color. So that color of Krishna, dresses of that color. So this shloka describes Bhishma Dev's meditation of favorite form of Krishna. Ravikara Gaurava Rambaram Dadane Vapur Alaka Kulavratana Nabjam. Alaka Kulavrata, again the word Alaka is coming, means his locks of black hair are covering his face. So that is the description. Another place it is said that just like when a lotus flower is there, many bees come to suck the nectar, drink the nectar from the lotus. So sometimes the lotus flower gets covered by black bees. Similarly, lotus face of Krishna with his curly black hair looks like the lotus flower covered by bees who are trying to drink the beauty of Krishna. An abjam Vijayasake. Vijayasaka means friend of Arjuna. Arjuna's another name is Vijaya. So Vijayasake Rati Rastu Mena Anavadya. Let me have attraction to you. So that's what Bhishma is telling. Without any fruitive results. Without any fruitive desires, let me have unflinching attraction to your lotus feet. So like this, here Krishna's beauty is again described. And can you think of any other section where Krishna's beauty is wonderfully described? There's one more which Brahmaji is describing. You can go to 114.1. Sri Brahmo Vacha. Nomidyate Bravapushe Tadidam Varaya. Difficult, huh? Nomidyate Bravapushe Tadidam Varaya. Gunjavatam Shapari Pichala Sanmukhaya. Vanya Srije Kavala Vetra Vishana Venum. Lakshma Shriye Mrudupade Pashupanga Jaya. This is after Brahma Yuman Lila. Brahma previously was considering Krishna to be an ordinary boy in Vrindavan. But after Krishna thoroughly tested him, bewildered him, Brahma offered his obeisances to Krishna, and when he got up, he could really appreciate the form of Krishna. It is said that Brahmaji's four heads were reeling when after seeing that Krishna is manifested, all the Vishnu Murtis, different Vishnu Murtis, and all Vishnu Murtis are entering into his body. Brahmaji's four heads were reeling. And they had a blackout. They could not remember anything. They had a blackout. And Brahmaji composed himself for some time. And he came back to his senses. And then he started offering this prayer. And the first prayer is like this. He is offering prayers to that small boy, whom he considered to be an ordinary child. So, see, kind of transformation he underwent. So Krishna, when his devotees become proud, he has his way of crushing that pride. So here he is saying, "Know me." Know me means I offer my obeisances. Know me dyate abra vabushe tadidambaraya. So one who is wearing tadidambaraya means the clothes. Tadit means lightning. The clothes which are shining like lightning, and his body which is like abra vabushe, like a rain cloud. So rain cloud and lightning, they are together. So that is kind of analogy is given here. Abravushe tadidambraya and gunjavatamshak paripichalasan mukhayam. So there is one kind of ornament called gunja, gunjamala, which they wear. Gunjavatamsha paripichalasan mukhaya, whose face is very bright and smiling. Vanya srije, vanya means forest, Srija means garland. Garland of forest flowers Krishna is wearing again. Vanya Srija Kavala Vetra. So this is unique here. All other things are same. But Kavala Vetra Vish. In his hand he is holding butter. So not butter, actually it's rice mixed with curd and some fruit. So that he is holding in his hand and he is searching. Where are my calves? Where are my gopas? And is completely ignoring Brahma. So that scene, to that form of Krishna, Brahma is offering obeisances. Kavala Vetra Vishana Venum, and is holding the Venum. Lakshma Shriye Mrudupade Pashubanga Jaya, and whose feet is very soft, Mrudupada, and which is decorated with many signs. Lakshma Shriye Murudupade Pashupanga Jaya. So this is also nice here. Pashupa means, Pashu means animals and specifically cows. Pashupa means one who protects the cows. Who is Nanda Maharaj? Pashupa Angaja means son of Nanda Maharaj. They offer obeisances to Sanda Nanda Maharaj. See, Brahmaji had such heart transformation after Krishna bewildered him and is glorifying Krishna's beauty in this way. So from this we understand that all the great devotees, they try to meditate on the form of Krishna, starting from his lotus feet up to the lotus face. By constant meditation of Krishna, what happens? Our mind becomes purified. As Kulashekar Maharaj, one of the great devotees in South India, he says, when you meditate on Lord Krishna, sa buddhir vimalendu shanka dhavala ya madhava dhyayini. Those who meditate on the form of Madhava, their intelligence becomes as white as a conch. Shanka dhavala. The conch, shanka, is spotless, very clean, looks very bright. So the buddhi of the person also becomes like shanka dhavala if he meditates constantly on the form of the Lord. So Rukmini also got attraction to Krishna by hearing about the description of the forms of Krishna. So it is so important to hear about the form of Krishna. God is a person. Some people think God has no form. How can you love? But they still talk of loving God. But how can you love a person whom you don't know how he looks? You don't know his name. Right? How can you love a Brahma Jyoti which has no form, no name, no address, no qualities? How can you fall in love with such a person, such a thing? Right? If you want to fall in love, you should get attracted to it. You should know the attributes and the qualities of that personality. Then you fall in love with him. So if you want to develop attraction to God and love him, we have to know his form and qualities, which is described in Srimad Bhagavatam. And you will see that any time any avatara comes, detailed description of that form comes. Again, it is repeated again and again and again in Srimad Bhagavatam. Every canto, every few chapters, description of Lord form comes, which goes to show that it is so important to hear the descriptions of the Lord. So it is not to be skipped. Oh, I already read. Let me skip it and go to the next section. So something like that. And even prayers. Sometimes prayers of different devotees appear similar, but that is very important. That is the essence of the devotion which is coming out through their heart. So one should try to hear those descriptions also. So Rukmini got attracted to Krishna by hearing about Krishna. Then she says that you are so wonderful, you are having so wonderful qualities, that who will not get attracted to you? Everybody will get attracted to you. But then she says that, oh Lord, this family, they have fixed a marriage with Shishupal and don't like Shishupal. Shishupal is such an envious personality. He is against you. I don't want to get married to him. Better I die than getting married to Shishupal. So like that she is thinking, and she is telling that I am like a deer, Hiran, and Krishna, you are like lion. And the deer is meant for the lion, not for a jackal like Shishupal. Actually, she uses the word jackal. And not Gomayuvan Mrigapatir Balim Ambujaksha. As the deer is meant for the lion, so please come and take me. The Shishupal, the jackal, is coming. Please save me. Like that she says. Then Krishna may think, how will I come? It's filled with enemies. Jarasandha, Shishupal, and all the armies are there. So Krishna may be thinking like that. So Rukmini says, no, don't worry. And Krishna may also think, no, if I come and there will be a lot of bloodshed and all. So what is the solution? Then Rukmini says, don't worry. I'll give you an idea. So you come to our place alone. Okay, because of lack of time, I'm cut-shorting. I'm not reading all the shlokas. She says, you come alone first. And let your army come behind. And when you come alone, people will not feel threatened, because alone what you will fight, they may think like that, because some people misunderstand that you are an ordinary human being with some little powers, so like that they think, so there will be no danger, so you come. And let the army surround you later on. Then Krishna may think, but when I am kidnapping you, then people may start fighting and I may have to kill your own relatives in your place. What about that? And Rukmiṇī says, no, don't worry. Just before the marriage, there is a ritual where we have to go to a temple of Bhavani. So she is writing that. She says, I'll go to the temple of Bhavani. So there, there will be no danger. Because that is the puja time and people will be peaceful. You come at that time. And from there you pick me up. And take. And because your soldiers would have already come, there will be no danger. You can easily defeat everybody and take them. So like this, she only gives the idea. She only is writing the letter. She only is giving the idea. And then she says, then she may be thinking, but what is the need? You may not come also. Because you are a self-satisfied personality. What if you don't come? Then she says, O lotus-eyed one, great souls like Lord Shiva hanker to bathe in the dust of your lotus feet. Right? Even Shiva, Shiva is taking, he is called Gangadhara. Because he took Ganga on his head. What is the specialty of this? It shows that Lord Shiva is a devotee of Lord Krishna, because Ganga is Charanamrita of Lord Krishna. Ganga is flowing from the lotus feet of Lord Vamana and washing or purifying all the worlds from Satyaloka up to all the Swargaloka. And when she is coming to Bhumi, at that time Shiva carries Ganga on his head. So his name became Gangadhara. See, Lord Shiva is hankering to take the dust of your lotus feet and thereby destroy their ignorance. If I cannot obtain your mercy, I shall simply give up my vital force. Means I'll give up my life, which will have become weak from the severe penances I will perform. Then after hundreds of lifetimes of endeavor, I may obtain your mercy. Suppose you don't come tomorrow. Because today she is writing, tomorrow is the marriage. Suppose you don't come tomorrow, what I will do? I will do such severe penance that I will die because of the penance. Then I will get a next birth. And I will again do penance. And if you don't come in next birth, I will keep on doing for hundreds of births. So this is what she is telling in this last verse. Jahya masun vrita krishan shata janma bisyat. For hundreds of lifetimes I'll wait, which goes to show that as sadhakas we also should be patient to get Krishna's mercy, and we should be ready to wait whatever time Krishna wants us to wait and sincerely perform a sadhana, and whenever Krishna's mercy comes, accept it. So that's what we should try to do, isn't it? So here Rukmiṇī is showing with the example, and Acharyas give a wonderful analogy. They say that Rukmiṇī is like Jivatma, like all of us. And Shishupal, Rukmiṇī, Jarasandha, they are like Maya. And they are capturing the Jiva and causing great suffering. And the Jiva is desiring liberation from that clutches. So at that time, the Guru plays a very important role. So, who is the Guru? Brahmana, who takes the message of the Jiva to Krishna. And Guru acts as an intermediary between the Jiva and Krishna. So, the Brahmana took the letter and read it to Krishna. And after hearing the letter and the cry of the Jiva, Lord Krishna personally comes to rescue the Jivatma. So there is an analogy. So means what? We should be very grateful to the spiritual master, and we should sincerely serve the spiritual master in order to get the mercy of Lord Krishna. So the spiritual master went, he carried the news, he gave the news to Krishna, and Krishna immediately called his army. Not his army, he called his driver Daruka and horses. And immediately put the horses, and he put the Brahmana on the chariot, and Krishna, Brahmana, along with Daruka, they start going fast. and they reached on time. Very fast they came. And Balaramji heard that Krishna has gone alone to fight with Jarasandha. He became concerned. So he immediately called all his army and he came with a huge Narayani Sena behind. And here Krishna comes and he reaches the outskirts of the city. And when he reached the outskirts of the city, all the citizens of the Vidarbha, they come to know that Krishna has come. And they go to meet Krishna. They're so jubilant. They also heard about Krishna. So by hearing about Krishna, they also developed attraction to Krishna. So some of them went, they were taking darshan of Krishna and they were so pleased to see him. And here Chediraj, Shishupal, Jarasandha, Shalva, Dantavakra, they are all coming and they are also there. And there is a little bit of chaos happening because they also heard that Krishna has come. So there is no, and it was morning time and the ritual's time had come. So Rukmini was eagerly waiting, anxiously waiting, where is Krishna, has he come, and the time for going to puja was coming soon. So she was anxiously looking with her eyes, she was looking, where is that Brahmana. So when she was looking like that, lot of thoughts were going in her mind, whether did he reach, Krishna gave the message, or what happened, or Krishna rejected, or like that, many thoughts are going on. But at that right moment, then Brahmana came. And then Brahmana came and Rukmini saw a smile on his face. And he was looking very satisfied and happy. And by seeing those Lakshanas, Rukmini could easily understand that good news. His Brahman cannot be so happy otherwise. And also her left arm and eyes were twitching. It is said that if for women, if the left part of the body twitches, it's a good sign. And for men, if the right eye and right hand twitching, that's a good sign. And bad sign means opposite. So Rukmini's left part was also a little twitching. So she felt a good sign. And Ramana came and he told, Krishna has come, he's waiting outside, in the outskirts of the city. Then Rukmini was so grateful to this Brahmana and she wanted to reciprocate and she did not know what to give because this Brahmana is already self-satisfied, is pure, what does he want? And so what she does is, she simply bows down. She keeps her head at the feet of Brahmana and bows down. Say, thank you. And even in some situations, in our own real life also, somebody does something so great help to us that we cannot even reciprocate in any way. At that time, what we do? Just bow down and say, thank you, sir. That's all. With grateful heart, we say thank you. So that's what it means. So she bowed down and thanked the Brahmana. And then she was carried on a palki to that Bhavani's temple. So when she went to the temple, there were a lot of rituals and puja was happening. And you may ask, why Rukmini is praying to Bhavani, Durga Devi, right? She is not praying for any material benedictions, give me money, give me bungalow, give me car, give me wealth, nothing. Many people nowadays go to Devi temples and pray for material wealth. But here, if you see, read the shloka, Rukmini says, Namaste Tava Ambike. She is praying to Ambika. What is it? So Sanatana Yutam Shivam, along with Shiva, she is praying to both of them. Bhuyat Patirime Bhagavan Krishna. Let my husband be Krishna. Tad Anumoditam. Like this, she requested. So this is what she prayed. And then a lot of puja and all happened. And at that time, puja got over and she came out of the temple and she was walking. And many kings were lined up to see Rukmini. But Rukmini had covered her body. In India, that's the custom, that women cover their body fully. And even in some cultured families, they even cover the face. So Rukmini had even covered her face and nobody was able to see her. But some people who could get a little glimpse of Rukmini, it is said that they fainted and fell from their horses and chariots. She was so attractive. And Rukmini was little bit removing her this thing to see whether Krishna has come. So at that time some people were falling down from their horses. And she was seeing, where is Krishna, where is Krishna? So at that time, this is 1053-56, there she saw Krishna. Krishna came. Yeah, at that time, at that moment she saw Krishna. Then while his enemies looked on, the Lord seized the princess who was eager to mount his chariot. Lifting the princess on his chariot, whose flag bore the emblem of Garuda, Lord Madhava drove back the circle of kings. With Balaram in the lead, he slowly exited, like a lion removing his prey from the midst of the jackals. Imagine, Krishna is fully surrounded by all kinds of enemies. Effortlessly, Krishna put Rukmini on the chariot. Peacefully, he is going. And all people are wondering what's happening. They could not even, they took some time to register at what happened. It happened so fast. And Krishna took and went away. The kings inimical to the Lord, headed by Jarasandha, could not tolerate this humiliating defeat. They exclaimed, "Oh, damn us! Thus, though we are mighty archers, mere cowherds have stolen our honor, just as puny animals might steal the honor of lions." Hare Krishna. This is the mentality of Jarasandha. He is still thinking that Krishna is a cowherd boy. They don't have the understanding that, no? Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead. So then there is a big fight which happens between Krishna, Balaram and all the armies of the enemies. And Balaram easily checks all the armies. But Rukmi was very angry especially. And Rukmi, he comes fighting and he is face to face with Krishna. So at the time, Krishna wanted to kill Rukmi, but he restrains, seeing that Rukmi is the brother of Rukmini. And if we kill, then Rukmini will be pained in the heart. So instead of killing him, he gives a nice haircut. For a Kshatriya, insult is worse than death. So he catches him and gives him a nice headshot and leaves him. Same thing happened with Ashwatthama also. Arjuna, instead of killing Ashwatthama, he gave him a nice little bit hair here, little bit hair. Now in Kali Yuga it has become fashion. People you hear like this, no, I don't know, but that is becoming a fashion, but that is a sign of insult, right? So people are taking such things to be fashion. I don't know, that is a Kali Yuga actually. At least devotees should not fall into the trap, no? They should look gentlemen. Srila Prabhupada said our devotees should look like perfect gentlemen, their hairstyle, their dressing style, right? Wearing a torn dhoti means torn shirt, torn pant and shirt means poor guy. But in Kali Yuga, that has become a fashion, and those kind of dressings are very costly also, I heard. And some jeans might be torn here, no? That's fashion nowadays. But that is a sign of insult in the previous. Certainly, devotees should dress very nicely in dhoti, kurta, traditional dress. Even if you go to your office, it should be in tip-top clothing, not imitate the hippies. That is hippie culture actually, wearing torn dresses and clothes. So then Rukmini was taken, and then in the next chapter, marriage of Rukmini and Krishna happens in Dwarka. And this is the first marriage of Krishna. First wife. And subsequently in the next chapter you will find how Krishna, no, not next chapter, in the further, how Krishna got other eight principal wives. Yamuna, then Krishna, Satyabhama, Kalindi, and Jambavati, right? Like this, eight principal queens. And then 16,000 queens were captured by one demon called Nargasura. And Krishna released all those queens and all the queens requested, kindly accept us also as your wife. Then Krishna married all of them and he got 16,108 queens. Right? Some people question how Krishna could, why Krishna married so many? Krishna is Supreme Lord, why not? Why only 16,000? He can have 16 million, 16 billion also. It is not a problem for him. And it is said that in Dwarka, Krishna was there in all the palaces simultaneously. He used to expand into 16,000 forms in all the palaces. And in the when he is going for the duty, when he is going to the office, all 16,000 will come into one. And one Krishna will come to the Sudharma Palace. So like this Krishna is performing. So if he has 16 million, he can expand into 16 million forms. Right? So that's the potency of Krishna. So there is nothing so to be so amazed about. Right? It is very easy for Krishna to do this. Like that. So from this lesson, from this passage of Rukmiṇī, marriage of Krishna, we can understand that how one should be only attracted to Krishna and nothing else. Understanding that all the beauties in this world are temporary, and everybody, all the bodies die, and the beauty ends with death, ends with old age also. So that's how one should become really attracted to Krishna, who is the personality to be attracted to, because he's so beautiful and is Adi Purusham. And then the process of developing attraction to Krishna is hearing. Rukmiṇī heard about Krishna, that's how she developed attraction to Krishna. Right? Even other great personalities, all devotees, you will see, they develop attraction to Krishna by hearing about Krishna. Prahlad Maharaj, did he see Krishna? He heard from Narada Muni. Parikshit Maharaj, did he see Krishna? He heard. What other examples? The Brahmana Patnis, did they see Krishna? Never. They heard about Krishna and then developed attraction to Krishna. Right? You will see all cases, we first hear about Krishna and then develop attraction. Then Krishna becomes pleased and gives us Sakshat Darshan. That is the standard process. Right? So then we also saw that how Guru's role is very important. That one should approach the spiritual master through devotees. Right? Brahmana also means any devotees who are dear to Krishna. So we approach through him, through the letter. So that letter represents the chanting of the holy names. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So Guru has given this process of writing a letter to Krishna for 2 hours every day. 16 rounds. So that's the day time where you can spend personal time with Krishna and write letter to him, like calling out to him for help. Oh Lord, I am caught up in this jackal, like Maya world. Kindly come and rescue me, kidnap me, whatever you do with me, take me to your lotus feet. Right? So that's the prayer which we can offer. And then Krishna comes. And when Krishna comes, we should be willing to give up all attachments. Right? Rukmiṇī was ready to give up all attachments and go towards Krishna wholeheartedly without any reservations. So like that. So that is a wonderful pastime which we discussed today. So thank you very much for your patient hearing.